Hi folks, Brent Bozell with the Media Research Center, and we have a very special guest, a fellow I've gotten to know a little bit, but who came out with a little book that has been causing all sorts of controversy with the left, which is exactly what I'm sure he wanted it. Donald Trump Jr. and his new book, Triggered.
Good to see you.
Thank you. Thank you for being with us. We came out with a new study today about the president and the impeachment inquiry. I want to ask you about the different elements of what we found and what your reaction is to them. The first one, your father has really outdone himself. You thought it couldn't get any worse than 90% negative coverage. It's gone up to 96% negative coverage. What does that say about the news media today and their coverage of news?
Well, they're underperforming greatly because they would love to be at 100% negative, Brent, because that's, listen, that's the reality of the world in which we live today. It's no secret that the media has been left-leaning for generations. The difference is today, they've just totally gotten rid of the pretense of objectivity. I mean, they have made a cognizant decision to say, hey, we are going to be the marketing arm of the left, and we will do whatever we can to further that message. They did it when they went all in for 2.5 years on collusion and treason and all this nonsense. The same tinfoil hat brigade that was leading that charge is leading this charge and would probably lead any charge, no matter how asinine, no matter how ridiculous, because again, they will do whatever they can to defend the far left.
It's a story that you would be interested in, which is the economy going gangbusters and stock market levels being broken one day after another. 4% coverage.
Well, they don't talk about that, and that's the reality. I mean, this is a president who's achieved what any other president would dream of, right? All-time low unemployment numbers for African-Americans, for Hispanics, for women, for veterans, all-time high startup businesses for the same demographics, 6.3 million people off of food stamps. By the way, prison reform, creation of opportunity zones. I mean, even his haters are like, well, he's doing all the things he said he would do, which is shocking, meaning they're used to politicians who aren't getting that done. But more importantly, he's doing that despite that sort of incoming. Imagine what he could accomplish for America and for Americans if he was just, maybe if they got a little cooperation, like 5%. Maybe if Nancy just took 30 seconds to put the USMCA on someone's desk and said, let's vote, because it would pass with bipartisan colors. But No. That could give Trump another win, and we would rather not do that, even if it meant incredible opportunity for Americans. And that's a sad state of affairs in politics. I mean, I talk about it sort of extensively in the book. I mean, you see that. Bill Maher, I really hope the economy just crumbles because that's our only chance of winning. I mean, he would want to see people thrown out of their jobs, lose their homes. He's okay risking their life. I mean, he's a rich guy from Hollywood, so it probably wouldn't affect him that much. It's just a few million less. But he's okay taking hardworking Americans and putting them through that kind of personal turmoil to achieve his political ends of, I don't like this guy, and so we can put in some leftist who will destroy the economy with asinine plans like a $93 trillion Green New Deal. Minor details, it's only 15 times U.S. government revenue, or Elizabeth Warren's, $52 trillion Medicare for All plan that would eliminate private insurance that people love and utilize 90% of U.S. government revenue over the next 10 years. I mean, I don't know. I'd rather do something that makes sense. But because there is no check and balance, because there is no adult in the room, the left can say whatever they want. It's just, oh, this is wonderful. I remember looking at the last debate, they spent more time talking about trying to take away Donald Trump's Twitter. They didn't even bring up China. Because, that all of them other than Joe Biden, I can understand why Joe Biden doesn't believe China's a threat, because his son's taking $1.5 billion from the Chinese government. So, when you're on the payroll, they're not a threat. But, all the other Democrats should be able to acknowledge that China's a threat and to not talk about it on a, 12-hour debate? I mean, maybe it just felt that way. But at least 3 hours. To not even talk about that as one of the major issues facing the country? No, they didn't do that, but they were able to talk about 17 derivations of the pronouns that they choose to go. I mean, what planet are we on?
Well, speaking of what planet are we on, The number that really jumped out at me. The president is commander-in-chief.
Yes.
This commander-in-chief ordered the execution and succeeded in the mission of killing the world's greatest living terrorist.
Yeah.
And yet for that, the news media gave him 67% negative coverage, yeah, to the point that you were making up before. Whose side are they on?
Again, my father used to get a lot of hell for saying, you know, the media are the enemy of the people. But you start seeing some of their headlines, you start seeing some of their action, and honestly, you have to wonder.
Yeah.
Okay, I mean, when I saw that, the immediate response was the Washington Post, right? Mm-hmm. You kill a known rapist, murderer, someone who's thrown homosexuals off buildings, someone who's doused journalists with gasoline and lit them on fire. Right? He's an austere religious scholar. That's what he is. I mean, yeah. Imagine, yeah, that's the filter by which people see their news. That you take a fact, just because Trump, I was at a speech last week where Pompeo said, hey, when Donald Trump walked me over to the CIA for the first time, that was his number one. That's, mm-hmm, he wanted to cut off the head of the state. He does it. And the Washington Post, where apparently, I'm told that that's where democracy dies in darkness. They have no problem with all the darkness going on in, you know, Adam Schiff's basement, you know, with the impeachment nonsense, you know, version 2.0 or 4.0, wherever the hell we are at this point. But, you know, for them to take a terrorist, the founder and leader of ISIS, shouldn't we all be able to agree that the world is a better place without this piece of garbage in existence? And they can't even do it. You know, the fact that he was like part of ISIS, like paragraph 37.
Yeah.
You know, then the New York Times follows it up and fact checks the meme. Right, the meme about a gold paw, Medal of Honor, around the dog that went into the cave. I mean, they're calling the way. I mean, you know, there's nothing. You know, there's nothing else shady to check. Maybe, you know, maybe look at where this whistleblower. Look at his connections to Joe Biden. Maybe look at his connections to Brennan. Mm-hmm. Maybe look. You know, that's what was the outrage cycle last week, where I said I retweeted an article that had the guy's name in the title of the article. Donald Trump Jr. Ouch. I outed him. Like, really? Like, I had a team of spies searching for this CIA operative, you know, deep state guy. Like, trust me, you know, they got much more spies on that side than we do on ours. I had no spies. It was literally in the title of an article. It was on the Drudge Report the day before. So the outrage of the day was I magically outed this guy. I go, seems like he's in the public domain to me. But you realize quickly, it wasn't that they were upset that I outed the guy. It's that now that the name is out there, you see it. You see that he had those connections. He's Biden's guest at a state dinner. He's, you know, Brennan's buddy who can get away with lying to Congress. No problem. You're on that side. You're good. It's nothing to see here. He's in the photo crying like a little child, you know, in front of the White House the day after my father won, you know, with Susan Rice. Yeah, this guy, this wasn't a setup from day one. This guy's mission was not from day one to try to take out Trump with his lawyer who's tweeting about a coup starting in January of 2017. Like, so they're mad because I put that out there and the rest of the world can say, here we go again. And it's why, while I've been on this book tour for the last, you know, week, I mean, I signed 3,000 books yesterday. Mm. You know how many people asked me about impeachment? Zero. Mm. Not one. Because everyone knows it's BS.
How's impeachment going? I want to be the first one.
You know, I see what's going on, and again, I read about democracy dying in darkness every other day when it's against Trump. But you know, I don't see anyone having a problem with Adam Schiff being judge, jury, executioner in this sham thing. The shade around all of these things. The only witnesses that they're putting forth seem to be the people that don't have firsthand knowledge. I've, you know, fourth-hand hearsay, mm-hmm, you know, and Adam Schiff gets to choose the people he wants. You know, after having heard them in closed-door sessions where he's able to either coach and or, like he did with Michael Cohen and others, like, who's the big boy in the room? Like, where's the media asking, okay, there's a little shade here, like, they don't care because it's getting to an end that they want, and they've eliminated any sort of desire for journalistic integrity. They can take anything and try to spin it to be negative to Trump, and if they can't, they're just going to ignore it.
What does it tell you? That I was bringing this up with some people just a little while ago. If on day one, Hunter Biden had come forward and said, for this I get paid, or got paid, yeah, $50,000 a month. If on day one he had said that, then there would have been a real issue here. Wait a minute. Why is he calling for an investigation? There is nothing to investigate here. doesn't it tell you something, Don, that not only has Hunter Biden not said what he was doing, but no one in the media are asking what it was.
You know, I mean, I saw a lot of people wearing shirts yesterday. Where's Hunter? You know, he did that ABC interview that was very well choreographed, and you could see, like, they're just whatever they can, and he still stumbled through it like a bumbling idiot, right? I mean, it was sort of amazing. I'm like, man, like, you know, if they gave him that fluff, and he had literally weeks to prepare. Well, so why were you on the board of Burisma? Oh, you know, I never really thought of that. Well, I know why.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, like, why did you, Hunter Biden, as a journeyman investor that no one else had ever heard of, when real investors, guys with track records, guys who've done actual things, you know, it takes them a decade, you know, to break into China to get investment dollars. Hunter Biden's magically able to do it in 5 days after traveling with Daddy on Air Force One. You know, and I just hear, I bring this up and they do the false equivalency. Well, you're the son of a rich guy. I go, yeah, I get it. I am. We made our money as business people. By the way, I was an international businessman for 15 years before we got into politics. When we got into politics, my father said, we're not doing new deals going forward. You know, we'll finish deals that we have because we have a contractual obligation, frankly. But we won't do a new deal going forward. That's frankly why I'm as into politics as I am, because I did probably 75-80% of our international business.
You got laid off.
So I didn't get quite laid off, but that was a big part of what I did. So I had a lot more free time. Because we said, hey, just to avoid any notion of impropriety, we'll stop. When Hunter Biden's father became the VP, that's when he magically said, hey, this is my opportunity. So we did it as businessmen who did that for a living. Hunter Biden became an international businessman off of his father's taxpayer-funded office. If Donald Trump Jr. did those things, we'd actually solve our fake news media problem because their heads would explode in outrage. Mm-hmm. You know, if Donald Trump Jr. Got a job at MBNA, minor details, happens to be the largest bank in the state of Delaware and the largest employer where Joe Biden is the senator and where he's signing favorable banking legislation. Hunter Biden, brilliant kid. He went through the ranks really quickly. You know, he then, because he's such an overperformer, you know, we've seen that obviously through him. He overperformed so much at 27, 28, whatever it was, he got on the board of Amtrak. Mm-hmm. Obviously had nothing to do with Dad holding the purse strings of Amtrak. He just got it because he liked trains. Mm-hmm. Like a lot of children, he probably had a train set growing up. And so that if I did any of those things, guys, there'd be outrage. And they try to do this false equivalency thing. They're not even the same. Why not, you know, put me and Hunter Biden across the table together and we can talk about our businesses before and after, you know, our parents', you know, political influence. It wouldn't be pretty. Okay. And by the way, then you get into even the personal side, right? You know, I've been attacked for 3 years for taking a 20-minute unsolicited meeting. Hillary Clinton can literally pay foreign operatives to go into other countries, collect dirt, leak it to the FBI, who leaks it to the press, who writes a story that the FBI then uses as the justification to start an investigation on American citizens, on the duly elected president of the United States, which started the original hoax. No, nothing to see here. I mean, you know, think about that false equivalency. Right. So, you know, I'm happy to have this conversation. It's great to be able to do it in this forum where you have sort of more than 280 characters or less to do it. The differences are outstanding, but again, it's so much of what I talk about in the book. It just shows you, you know, the never-ending bias of the left. And it is powerful, and it's why we do have to fight, and it's why my father does have to be vocal. Because once you filter what he actually says and what he's actually doing through their, you know, filter of hate, and at this point, it's just outright hate. Mm-hmm. You really have to combat that. And that's also why you have to combat the social media censorship, mm-hmm. which obviously you guys do a lot doing, because they will do whatever they can to minimize his message, to make sure the fewest amount of people see it, while also getting incredible protections from the U.S. government. If the left were doing that, there'd be outrage. They'd be shutting things down. The right has to start fighting the same way.
Well, I mean, on the Twitter thing, you and I have talked about this mm-hmm. in the past. We set up the Free Speech Alliance. We have over 60 organizations now because I see that as the biggest threat to democracy today. When you have got a social media industry, a world where hundreds of millions, in some cases billions in others, go there, and it has a policy agenda where it is shutting down the pro-life movement, it's shutting down the NRA and the pro-gun movement systematically. That's a real threat. Politically, however, there is no one that, to my view, and I want you to comment on this, no one, to my view, they obviously that they despise more than your father. But here's where I see as really dangerous. At the very top, you might have people who say, I don't like him. But as in the case of Mark Zuckerberg, I don't like him. But we have to be the free market of ideas. Yeah. But at a secondary level, they could care less about what happens to their company. They want to get
that's the problem. I mean, you know, I don't think Mark Zuckerberg's a conservative. I think he's probably a pretty active, left-leaning individual. But I don't believe he's got full control of that ship. Mm-hmm. I think the problem is they got tens of thousands of employees that all believe the same sort of Silicon Valley, not Democrat think, because we have to make the distinction, frankly, these days between Democrat and leftist. Mm-hmm. You know, the party, the Democrat Party, has been taken over by leftists. Mm-hmm. I would say when I'm in, the Rust Belt, this is not your grandfather's Democrat mm-hmm. Party. I mean, the people that were the leaders of that movement, they'd be, alt-right, terrible, they canceled. Mm-hmm. And so that's the reality. I mean, when you have, tens of thousands of employees that all have that same think, it is our obligation to shut this. I don't know that anyone actually knows what's actually going on, but you have enough people saying, I'm going to follow this kind of content. I've been vocal about it, whether it's my Twitter, whether it's my Instagram, whatever. People shutting me down for hate speech. They've shut me down for hate speech for asking the Jussie Smollett one, right?
Right.
I don't know, guys. It seems a little ridiculous. Everyone just, this is obviously true. It obviously happened. A really rich guy wanted to go get Subway at 2 in the morning on the coldest night of the year. And obviously, white supremacists and MAGA hat who must be big fans of Empire knew he'd be doing that. So they're walking the streets of downtown Chicago without getting shot. I don't know, guys. Jussie may be an average actor, but he's a really bad writer. If we ask this question, hate speech. We can't ask a question in 2019 anymore. For other things. And then when I started calling it out, the amount of people, the amount of outreach I got, to my DMs, things I don't even check all that often. If I'm not following them, it doesn't appear. I literally have to go look, but I will because I'm kind of curious to see. These are guys that know there's almost 0% chance I'm going to see what they're sending me. Mm-hmm. And they're writing out paragraphs. They're sending me video and pictures and this. I tried liking a picture that your father posted of him and his grandkids. And you just see the little heart goes on and goes off. Heart goes on, goes off. Heart goes on, goes off. Next thing, you've been locked out of your account for 24 hours for promoting hate speech. It never ends. The Second Amendment accounts, the Christian type accounts. I did it myself 10 days ago. My handle, my actual handle, Donald J. Trump Jr., into Instagram. Mm-hmm. I didn't show up on the first 6 pages of the scroll. I have 2 million followers. I did something like 75 million impressions that week or whatever it was. And I share the name of the President of the United States with 15 million plus. Neither of us showed up. But, okay. Donald Trump _ Jr. _83642 $1 with 2 followers and 1 post. He shows up on the front page. You telling me they're not trying to censor me? You telling me they're not trying to prevent us from getting our message out there? How many people are not seeing? Kimberly, my girlfriend, maybe she was mad at me a couple times. Don, I had to follow you 4 times this week. You don't show up in my feed. It's 2 of those times she may have unfollowed me. The rest, they're literally just haphazardly saying, okay, yeah, that person's not following. Other big accounts are no longer going to see your content. Scary stuff. There are a couple of guys. Josh Hawley's been pretty vocal about it in the Senate. McCarthy's being pretty vocal about it in the House. But I do also want to see more action. Yeah. So many conservatives never even understood that it's an issue. Meaning it's an issue with the base, but leadership in the House and Senate didn't get that it's an issue with their people. I think once they figure that out and they start pushing for it, honestly, even some of the Democrats are pushing for it, albeit from a different sort of mm-hmm. angle. We got to get this thing reined in because it is a dry run for suppression for 2020.
Yeah, 2 more questions for you. One, what does it say about the threat to democracy? We're talking about a presidential campaign. Talk about Russian interference all day long. Yeah. But yeah. I'm talking about power.
$100,000 in Facebook ads. that's not a big deal. But literally stymieing millions and millions and millions of people.
It's not that it's advertising on Facebook. It's Facebook. It's Twitter. Right. It's Palo Alto. What does that say about democracy? Well, the threat to it.
It is. It's a major threat. That's how people, communicate. That's how people get their news. And because they're saying, hey, you know, I should be seeing the stuff that I follow. They assume that they are, and they're not. I mean, you can't imagine how many people have reached out to me. Hey, man, I'm following like all these leftist, like, you know, news organizations. I never signed up for them. They're not appearing as like sponsored content. They're just showing up in my feed as though I'm following them. You know, that's the big one. So they're doing whatever they can to change the message, to change, you know, how it's being perceived. And again, for someone like me who's sort of, you know, become a student of the game because it's been manipulated, it's out there. I mean, enough. I get enough people reaching out. Like, okay, maybe I can catch it. But you think the guy with 200 friends,
right?
You think he's seeing it? He may not be. He may not even know what's going on. And you know, they can move needles. You know, in elections where, you know, things are coming down to basis points, in many cases.
Yeah.
You know, they can make a big difference. And make no mistake, they are trying, and they will try to do it again. So, you know, we have to get all over this, not just for this election, but for the future. For our values, for the America that we believe in, the America that we want our kids to grow up in, you know, their views are very different. I mean, man, I spend a big part of the book writing about, you know, me being sort of an unlikely conservative. You know, I'm the son of a billionaire from New York City who went to an Ivy League school. Like, I'm not supposed to be, but, you know, I have a mother that escaped communist Czechoslovakia. Yeah. You know, I used to go over there as a child. I've waited in the, it is. I mean, I get into much greater detail, but, like, I've been there. I've seen it. Like, you know, it's interesting to me how today, this has become a mainstream thing for the left, like socialism, communism. Like, it's wonderful. Like I've waited in those bread lines. I can assure you, it's not so awesome. You know, my 93-year-old grandmother, who's still alive, literally calls me every few weeks in tears because she has CNN. She doesn't have, you know, a conservative outlet to see the other viewpoint over in Europe. No. You don't understand. It's always free. It's always so good. It never. She's in tears.
Right.
And again, this isn't just like a, you know, a frail old grandmother. I mean, this is someone who hid it from the Nazis in the basement of her farmhouse for 2 years. It's a young, you know, young adult. It's someone who'd lived through 40 years of that occupation. You know, she's seen it. I go, you know, like, Brent, you've seen the debates. The far left, they'll get someone who can vouch and say anything because there's no checks and balances. No one's going to call them out. I mean, you've heard all the asinine things that they will espouse. How come there's not someone, not one person, from like what was the former Soviet Union, China, former Eastern Bloc, Europe? How about closer to home? How come there's not one person from Cuba or Venezuela, not one, who's lived there, come here and said, no, we got to bring that stuff over here? That's 100 million people, easy, more. Not one has said, we got to bring that failed experiment that has failed over and over, caused the death of, you know, over 100 million people. Not one person has said, no, let's bring that stuff here. You know, yet, you know, academics and Bernie, oh no, it's wonderful. This is crazy.
Yeah.
And so, you know, we have to fight against that, but we're not fighting on a level playing field. We're not on a level battlefield. We're fighting uphill, you know, with two arms and a leg tied behind our back, you know, because of all those things, because of the media, because of the suppression, because of this. Now, the facts work in our favor. The facts are like, you know, kryptonite for the left.
Right.
But again, the average guy may not be getting the facts because he's getting 96% negative coverage despite unprecedented success.
Final question I'm going to ask. There are tens of millions, there are more than that out there in the real world that are truly concerned about what's being done to your father. And what's being done to your family, what's being done to you.
Hey, I was number two target.
With that in mind, offer them words of encouragement about what they should do. Feel free to give a shameless plug to the Media Research Center.
Yeah.
But do offer them encouragement. Mobilize the base to come to your father's defense.
And that's what it is. I say that. I mean, I see that, you know, again, I signed 3,000 books yesterday. People, hey, Trump 2020, I mean, you know, so Trump 2024, I'm like, let's worry about 2020. But like, but you need to be in the fight with us. You can't just vote. You got to be vocal. You got to talk to your friends. I mean, the media has actively tried to make, you know, if you're a Trump supporter, you're bad. If you want to live your American dream, you're bad. If you want your taxpayer dollars to go to help your kids live the American dream rather than some piece of garbage in a country that hates our guts that we're sending money to for, you're a terrible person, Brent. You should be ashamed of yourself. You know, we saw that in 2016 when we did polling, online versus telephone. There was a 15% spread, large sample sets, right? Statistics dictates you should be within basis points of each other, right? People didn't want to get bullied on the phone. You know, if you were a Trump supporter, you must be a racist, you must be this. you know, it's all nonsense. Mm-hmm. I think they see that, but they've been put in their place, and they're afraid to speak up. It's a scary thing. Those people need to start being vocal. They do need to get out there. They need to speak to their friends. They got to talk about those facts. You could do that in a nice way. Yep. You don't have to go to war every day, but you do sort of have to speak up. It was the story I used to sort of exemplify it. With Kimberly, we went to Valentine's Day dinner. She wanted me to take her to a restaurant on the Upper East Side of New York. I'm like, this is, you know, not exactly a bastion of, you know, conservative think. And, you know, I'm like, great. You know, I'd rather just order at home and, you know, I'll cook. We'll make it romantic, I promise. Not necessarily, I promise, kind of, because it's not exactly my strong suit. You need a wrecking ball, I'm your guy. Romance, not so much. But she convinced me to take her to this restaurant. And we're there, little small place on the Upper East Side. We didn't, you know, nice dinner, but at the same time, I'm miserable because I'm looking, and I'm sitting there thinking, everyone is giving me side eye. Right. You know, everyone's looking at me, and I'm like, who's the guy? Mm-hmm. You know, who's the guy that's going to start a fight? Who's the guy that's going to do something that I'm going to have to, you know, defend, you know, as they've done, to, you know, spitting on my brother in a restaurant in Chicago and these sort of things. You know, you don't hear about those things because, again, the tolerant left, not so tolerant. But so I'm sitting there the whole time. I'm basically miserable. It was a nice meal, but, you know, when you're not in the zone, you're not in that, in the mood, you're not in that zone, it's a little bit harder. And we're walking out, and a nice old lady stands up, and she just goes, "You!" I'm like, yeah, here we go. This was quintessential New Yorker. And I'm like, I mean, it wasn't quiet. It was loud. And literally now all eyes are on us. And I thought they were basically all meal anyway, but now they're on us paying attention. And she just goes, "You guys have the biggest, I don't know if it's for Facebook, but BALLS I've ever seen. And I love it." And so this was not what I was expecting, right? Mm-hmm. I thought, you know, I'm going to have to punch an old lady here. Just kidding. Just kidding. Because, you know, Donald Trump Jr. assaults old lady.
You just wrote the headlines for tomorrow.
I did. It's all over. But, you know, so this woman starts, and she's screaming this at this restaurant. Like, I love, you don't care. You just give it back to them. You take the fight to them for a change. I don't think she was even a conservative. Mm-hmm. She was just sick of being manipulated. Yeah, she was sick of, like, just hearing one thing that she knows not to be true. You know, and literally everyone else in the restaurant, everyone, just turns around.
Really?
Starts clapping. We were there for 25 minutes taking selfies. This is the Upper East Side of New York. Mm-hmm. This is not, because people were like, you know what? They may not be Republican, right? But they didn't have to hate you. They didn't have to, they could say, you know what? I may disagree with you, but I appreciate that you have the guts to actually be out in the fight. Again, I'm not saying they all were in agreement. But there wasn't one person in that restaurant, I don't think, that we didn't take a selfie with, that didn't come up, give you a handshake, look you in the eyes, and you understand that you're doing what you believed right as an American. And so I think there's so many of those Americans out there. Like,
that's right.
You know, they're a little afraid. They need that little old lady to have the guts to step up and say it out loud, to then be like, you know, yeah. I see it. That's, you get the sort of subtle, you know, let's hide the little thumbs up here. You know, we'll give it to you. Need that guy to take that next step. Be a little bit more vocal. If you do, I can assure you there's so many more like you than you'd ever imagine. And I think that's why polling doesn't mean anything. When they're, you know, Michael Bloomberg, 6 points ahead of Trump. Like, sure. Yeah. Soda bans, you know, that's going to go over great with, like, freedom-loving Americans. Like, the nanny state, they're going to love that in Pennsylvania and Ohio and Michigan. It's going to be awesome. Like, good luck. Yeah. You know, money can't buy personality, and it can't get rid of the notion of that you're trying to impose those kind of things on the American people. And, you know, again, if you look at any other of the candidates, you just pick them apart. You know, you look at Joe Biden. I mean, he's been running on a campaign of government has failed you. I'm actually with you on this one, Joe, but, like, you've been in government for 50 years. You've been in Senate for, like, 30. Like, maybe you're part of the problem. Like, where were you for 50 years? How are you going to change it now? Why didn't you do it then? And, again, because you're on that side, and they're like, you know, well, maybe that's the guy that can actually beat Trump. I mean, he used a teleprompter to speak to 20 people the other day. I mean, you know, one-on-one with Trump for 6 months is going to be really, really awesome. Like, good luck with that, guys. Like, I think, you know, please, like, Christmas would come early this year. But that's what we're up against. Yeah. And so, you know, I think there's so many more of those reasonable people that, again, even if they're not on your side, I think they see what's happening and they're disgusted. You know, I get that. I wish they just let him do his job. Yeah. I saw that in D.C. airport the other day. I mean, listen, man, I'm a Democrat, but, like, I'd love to let him just do his job.
That's right.
And they haven't, But that's okay, because he succeeded anyway. But if he had a little bit more help, just a little bit, imagine what they could do. I mean, how about sign the USMCA? Get these things off the desk. Benefit the American people. Even if it means a win for Trump. Nancy, maybe be the better person yourself. They talk about, oh, we want a new era of civility. Well, I don't know. You're sitting on a bill that would benefit hundreds of thousands of Americans, but you won't bring it to the floor because it means there would also be a win for Trump. Don't lecture me on civility.
The book is Triggered. Everyone should read it. Or watch The View, a rerun of The View. Look, good luck. You don't need my luck on this, but good luck to you on this. Keep up the very good work you're doing.
Appreciate it.
Thank you.
Good being with you.
Thank you.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you.